So I'm Benjamin Linard. I'm a postdoc in the lab of Alfred Vogler. And I joined the museum, in fact, because of this initiative, the biodiversity initiative. One of its goals is in particular to integrate taxonomy, biodiversity studies with the new methods of genomics, more precisely iSequencing. So maybe you was to the symposium that we did a few weeks ago. If it's the case, you see more or less the kind of subject. Today, I will present you briefly the kind of result that we have and the computational costs that we need to produce these results and which is the future that we look for this kind of studies. So I took back some slides that we presented in this symposium. In the lab, in particular, we are interested by arthropods. And one of our test cases was, in fact, to use beetles. In fact, just a sample of 500 beetles, for example, caught in a trap. This one are coming from Borneo in particular. We put everything together, mix the soup, the DNA. I will not talk about the barcode, because now the new approach is to take this DNA, put it into the sequencer machine, assemble this DNA to find the contigs, this piece of chromosomes that comes from these different insects. And from there, one of the first steps of the lab was to study mitochondrial DNA. So in a typical sample like this one, we have around 5% of mitochondrial DNA. Alex, that is a PhD student in our lab, did some amazing work. And in fact, we were able to find most of the species probably that were in the sample. We don't have complete mitochondria for most of them, but we have enough information to be able to differentiate a lot of species directly from the metagenomic sample. Moreover, when we have that, we can do lots of stuff, find again, the family, maybe go to the species level for some of them if we have enough mitochondrial information. And an interesting point is also that maybe we are able to go to some information like abundance by linking the proportion of DNA in the sample to the number of species. And it's still not perfect. Where's the pointer? Yeah. It's still not perfect, but we begin to have correlations. So, yeah, there is lots of potential in this kind of studies. Okay, and then I came back, I came into museum, sorry, and I just thought, okay, that's cool, we can do lots of stuff with the mitochondrial DNA, and Alfred was very, very curious to know what are the 95% that are left. So we checked, in fact, half of that is clearly Coleoptera DNA, because we have a sample that is mostly a soup of beetles. So potentially, we can go further, not only be focused on taxonomy and abundance, but also go to pure genomic analysis, like it's done with all the reference genomes that we have now, for example, in the mammals, and then do functional analysis. So I was looking at that, and in fact, if you just extract the proteins that are there and that are more close to the beetle reference genomes than anything else, you just see that you have a huge coverage. Here are four different samples from four different soup. We find a decent coverage of homologs between the samples to be able to compare the samples. That means that we can compare different soups, and what is also interesting is to see the difference. What is unique to a particular soup, it's to say what is unique in terms of DNA to a particular place, a particular sample. Okay. I also mapped all that to the only beetle reference genome that is currently sequenced, that is Tribolium castaneum. What is important here is, in fact, the red part. What is red are the contigs, the piece of DNA that we are able to map to its chromosomes. That means that in our soup of arthropods, we can, in fact, cover a decent piece of the chromosome. So we can go back to genomic information. We have references, and we can do it. The fact is now there is only a few beetle genomes that are sequenced, and I will go back to that later. But looking at this kind of results, I'm pretty sure that we can go to genomic analysis. So, to summarize, doing all that, what does it cost in terms of computing? So, for one soup, the machine that we used has 128 gigabytes of memory, 20 times more than a classical computer, and 24 CPU core. Okay? For the mitochondrial part, it's not so intensive in terms of computation, 10 gigabytes of memory, 12 hours of calculation, and a few gigaoctets of space for the data. For the total DNA, when we want to go further and analyze the whole soup, the 100% of DNA, it's much more complicated. And then the needs in terms of computation begins to explode, in fact. What we did currently is to use 100 gigabytes of memory. We still let 20 gigabytes because a lot of other people are doing informatic research and use the computer, so we cannot, you know, just use everything. Everybody will complain. So 5 days to do that. That's the space that was needed on the disk, but I mean, if you keep only the information that is relevant and useful, it would be more like 50 gigabytes. Here is a graph of what are the computations exactly. It's a software that is called Moonin that allows us to monitor the server, in fact. That's our last DNA assembly from a few days ago, starting here, finishing there. So this one was 4 days of calculation. We speak at 80 gigabytes of memory. That's an easy case, working fine, fast. If we look the last weeks and the last months for what we did, we have several assemblies with different samples, and also the same sample is sometimes started again. Why? Because our assembly is crashing. It's the red cases. Why it's crashing? Because the algorithm cannot resolve the DNA alignment, because we don't have enough memory. In fact, the current limit that I put is 100, and as you can see, we are reaching the memory, so it's crashing when it doesn't crash the server. So, yeah, that's the typical case, and on average, 1.5 assembly per week. That's the last month. As you can see, it's very, very variable depending on the sample. This sample here in June took 3 weeks and a half of calculation, full memory. We could not do anything else at the same time, and it crashed at the end. Okay, so unresolved. Some other cases in April and May, that was only 1 week, more or less, okay, but also full memory. And in fact, when there's these red peaks there, it just means that the server is not able to work correctly because, yeah, there is not enough memory. So the issue that we have now in terms of computation is that we can do only one assembly at a time. When it's crashing, we can just start and wait again for weeks. We cannot do several stuff at the same time. We cannot play with the parameters of the assembly, which would be really nice in terms of science to understand how to optimize the assembly and have better DNA. In terms of CPU for the genomic analysis, so that's what I started when I came a few months ago. I did a lot of homology studies, alignments, statistics, some graph for all these representations. It doesn't need any memory. It can be done in any computer, but the fact is that you need a lot of CPU, so it's difficult. The space is not an issue also. And all that is supported by a SQL database that is on the same server, but is using space. So what's the future? That's what we need for one soup. The fact is that we want to do biodiversity, and not only biodiversity, also genomics. So if we don't focus only on the mitochondrial stuff and want to do genomic analysis, we will have to follow standards of metagenomics that will be very CPU cost, that will cost lots of CPU. So it will not only be a problem of memory anymore, but also CPU. Because there I did all that for only 2 beetle genomes. But what is coming now, it's dozens of beetle genomes that will be available in the coming years. So the analysis could become very big. And finally, to achieve everything, we want to do biodiversity. We don't want to study 5, 6 soups. We want to do dozens of soups. Why? Because we want to do different traps, different levels in the forest, from the canopy to the ground. Moreover, we want to do different plots over different gradients, like, for example, attitude gradients. So what we will have, in fact, is a batch of soup. So that is the main issue. For the mitochondrial analysis, taxonomy abundance, okay. But if you want to go to full DNA analysis which has a lot of potential, we will be totally stuck. One of the solutions could be to pool DNA. For example, let's put all the canopy traps from these plots together. Why not? But we will lose resolution. It's a shame, in fact, to do this kind of stuff because we have the data. We have the DNA. It's just a computational problem. So the question is, how much computational power could we have to do better science and to have more resolution in terms of DNA and go to the genomics to in a more interesting level? Okay, and all that for what? Because there is something that I didn't saw a lot in all the talks. It's the fact that the DNA, the molecular part, for me, is also an essential part of a record. If, imagine in the museum, you have this data portal, we could provide new metadata that are in the molecular side. Why? Because with one sample, we identified species, we identified some functions, some genes, we could just transfer all this knowledge. And then when you search a particular species, you could have not only 8 specimens, 4 images, but also 2 metagenomic samples, and you know that there is DNA in the NHM that is available, and that we found in Borneo, in this particular site, at this particular date. Oh, and then you can look which other species are there in the same time in this sample, through the molecular basis. Okay, thank you for your attention.